segment of the show for today. The topic is the revolution in Egypt and its impact upon surrounding Arab nations. Dr. Madhu, let's pick up where we left off last time and to give you an opportunity to continue talking about the impact that this revolution has already had upon Arab states. Go on and give us that information.
Like I said, you know, the Kingdom of Morocco, you know, also faces a lot of challenges. And like I said, in the mid-70s, you know, the king at that time, Hassan, you know, was nearly overthrown twice. The first time in 71, having his birthday at his seaside palace, soldiers burst in there to assassinate him. Over 100 were killed. He miraculously escaped. Then in 1972, his Minister of Defense, General Mohamed Oufkir, you know, organized a coup and then nearly shot his plane out of the sky. He miraculously escaped and had everybody executed, you know. So there has been opposition to the regime, you know, in Morocco for a long time. So even when the son came in, you know, King Mohammed VI in 1999, he made some cosmetic changes. You know what I mean? Here he released some political prisoners and you know it. But still, underneath, people want, complete reform. They want a constitutional monarchy instead of an absolute monarchy like you have there now. Corruption, you know, bring people to book about the king spends about $750,000 a day to maintain his residences. Okay, for such a country, yeah, think about that. Yes, a day to maintain the royal palaces and households and concubines and you name it. You know, now you move over to Syria. The same. Syria has been under the rule of one family since about 1971. Hafez al-Assad, the father of the current president, you know, came to power through a coup in 71. He was there till he died in 2000. When he died in 2000, he handed over to his son, Bashar al-Assad, as president. Bashar is still in power now. There have been demonstrations in Syria, you know, for economic and political reforms. You know, Syria is a very repressive government. Syria is one place, you know, I think some profound might happen. Though Assad's family has been there from 71, you know, through a repressive political apparatus, but they are running a minority regime. In Islam, you know, you have different sects. The Assad family comes from the Alawite sect, which is a syncretic form of Islam. The majority, you know, of Syrians are Sunni. In fact, in 1982, a Sunni, you know, Islamic movement, you know, started a rebellion in the city of Hama. Over 10,000 were slaughtered, according to reports, in a few days by Assad soldiers to crush that Sunni movement. So that group is now reorganizing, you know, again, you know, to try and remove the government of Assad and his family. So that's a place to watch. In Bahrain, you know, Bahrain is one that is causing the U.S. government a lot of problems now. Bahrain is the headquarters of the U.S. Fifth Fleet in the Mediterranean, you know. And so it threatens America's interests, what happens there. The problem, or what makes Bahrain's case interesting, is Bahrain is also a minority-ruled government. The royal family, the caliphs, you know, are Sunnis. But the majority of Bahrainis are Shiites, the same kind of Islam you have in Iran. So it makes it very difficult, you know, for them to retain power outside using repressive measures, because the majority, even if there's democratic vote,
they're out.
Exactly, the Shiites will still vote them out. So it's creating a whole lot of concern how the Obama government administration, you know, balances our interest in keeping that place safe for our fleet, at the same time supporting the democratic aspirations of the Bahraini people. It's very tricky. So right now, some about 5 have been killed in the demonstrations, and 200 wounded. You know, there are tanks on the street and all that. So that's a very tricky situation. In Kuwait, you know, there's also demonstrations in Kuwait. Remember, Kuwait is also a repressive society, you know, whichever way you look at it. A place where women, you know, can't even drive and all that. So it's also very tricky because Kuwait you know, it's close to Iran. Mm-hmm. And so it's a very tricky
situation.
And we've
been there before.
And we've been there before, mm-hmm. you know. And there are some demonstrations in Iran now, mm-hmm. like you've read in the paper. Mm-hmm. But, you know, they're trying to stop it mm-hmm. from happening. However, you know, Iran is different in a way from the other regimes, mm-hmm. you know, in the Arab world, in that there's an institutionalized theocracy, mm-hmm. you know, that runs the country. It's not dependent on one strong man like mm-hmm. Mubarak or Gaddafi. Mm-hmm. You know,
they it's have a group of individuals.
Exactly, mm-hmm. you have an institution. Mm-hmm. You know, you have the presidency. You have the Velayat al-Figi. You know, mm-hmm. who is the supreme leader. Then the Council of Guardians and the Parliament, mm-hmm. the Majlis, which some of these other places don't have. Mm-hmm. You know, as an institution. Mm-hmm. So in Iran, the demonstrators will be challenging an institution.
Well, then
in other countries, mm-hmm. exactly, the demonstrator will be challenging mm-hmm. an individual who represents, you know, the power structure. Mm-hmm. So that is very, very important. Mm-hmm. And of course, the Palestinian territories, you know, are kind of quiet now. I don't think they have anything to demonstrate for mm-hmm. or against. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Abbas is trying to, you know, do a good job of mm-hmm. keeping a lead on terrorists mm-hmm. Who are now living in Gaza.